If you had told me a week ago that this is what Alabama was gonna look like, I would have said no way.
No way. No way.
But after spending a few days in the state, we've really been caught off guard. They've got beautiful mountain landscapes, lakes, rivers, and massive caves. Today we gained a much deeper appreciation for the state after romping around in the forest with Bill Finch and a team of botanists who helped us realize just how much biological diversity there really is in the southeast forests of the United States.
So this is the northeastern corner of Alabama where we are right now. It's where the Cumberlands break down and are just sliced into by the Tennessee River. And on those steep slopes, all of this limestone that's 300 million years old, 400 million years old gets exposed. And when it does, a lot of weird plants end up growing there. When I was growing up, I guess when you grow up running around in the woods, you kind of want to say, what's that? Why does that smell funny? You know? What does that taste like? And nobody could tell me what I was looking at. It's very frustrating. So I decided, you know, I'm gonna figure out what these things are. There's southern red oak. Northern red oak is up there, which are very different trees, even though they have the same sort of names. Cherry bark oaks, which are typical bottomland oaks, really nice specimens. Jumard oak, Quercus stellata, what's the common name? Post oak, and then we got northern shagbark and shell bark, and elms and ash and maples, trees that most people have never heard of, like chittum wood or smoke trees. We've basically taken hundreds of acres of forest and said, okay, we're gonna measure every stem in here. We're gonna measure every plant in here that's over the size of a pencil. And not only that, we have to identify each one. And then we have to measure it. And then in 5 years, we come back and measure it again. And in 5 years, we measure it again for 50 years. So it's a major project.
Among the 4,000 acres of the Nature Conservancy's Sharp Bingham Preserve, the research center has partnered with Alabama A&M to provide training, research, and fellowship programs for underserved populations.
Of course, in a place like this, we're going to find a lot of species that we didn't realize were in this particular patch of woods. That's not unusual, but finding something that's potentially new to science, that's really rare. Really rare. You know, after some false alarms where you say, oh, this is a new species, and then you send it out to your buddies and they say, oh, you jerk, this is this is so-and-so, so-and-so.
Sanguinaria canadensis. That's the reason it's called bloodroot.
The issue is we don't know why forests are the way they are. We don't know why they assemble. We don't know why some forests are richer than other forests. We know that the forests have responded to climate change in the past in pretty big ways. And some forests have fared fairly well. So these forests have survived climate change in pretty good shape.
I'm going to stop real quick. I'm going to call Tam over if that's all right.
Tambo!
Come here, bud.
Hey.
So we've got to understand how forests work to understand how to preserve our diversity in our forest. The future of the forest of North America in New England may depend on what happens in Alabama and Georgia and Northwest Florida, because that's where the diversity is. That's where the heat tolerance is. That's where the pathogen tolerance is. And that's what's, it's all moving that direction.
This group of sedges is notoriously difficult. Even experts that see tend to lump them into this category or that category, but really there's a whole complex of unappreciated diversity that just sort of gets lumped together. And if we're going to conserve biodiversity as much as we can, then we first need to sort of have an appreciation for what's there.
Night temperatures are getting warmer. And that's having a huge impact on plants for a lot of reasons. Okra is really well adapted to high night temperatures, but things like tomatoes are less well adapted to high night temperatures. So I think things like mitella, they're only in places where the night temperatures stay cool, which is right around this cave mouth. Climate's changing again, and we're really concerned about how forests are gonna respond to that, how they may adapt to the excess carbon that's in the air now, how they may adapt to temperature changes, how they may adapt to changes in pathogens and other things that can occur as a result of climate change. In a real, very real way, these forests, because of their richness and because they are in a relatively warm place, may be the future of forests throughout eastern North America.
So this video was actually filmed back in the spring of 2019, and since then the center has carried out a ton of new projects and forest consensus work. They've even discovered some species new to science, such as new oaks and new violets.
If you'd like to support these
if you want to support these rad botanists, go to paintrock.org. Support their mission, share their content, and if you can, consider making a donation. As always, thanks for stopping by here at Local Motives. If you like this video, smash that like button. And if you want to see more, gently tap the subscribe button, and we'll see you next time. Good night, folks.